So good afternoon to everyone. My colleagues and I want to present you new data provided by the archaeobotanical analysis based on fruit and seed remains done in the site of Latara, located in southern France. We would like to discuss about the characteristics of plant consumption and trade during the Roman times. But to better understand what happens during this last period and identify the new Roman plants or plant products, we will also take into account data from the previous Iron Age periods. The question of trade will be explored using amphora data for assessing possible origins. Latara is a trading post located in a lagoon shore with a close river, as you can see on your left. From this location, the inhabitants control not only the seacoast, but also the fluvial ways to the hinterland. This urban site, fortified, presents a continuous occupation from the beginnings of the 5th century BC to at least the 2nd century AD. We can observe a strong presence of, for instance, Etruscans, probably merchants, in the very early moments of the site, but Greeks from Massalia quickly replaced them. During the Iron Age, we can say that Latara is a Gallic indigenous site presenting abundant elements of foreign origin. The Roman period, in the site you can see down on your right, is poorly attested in the intramural area because the upper level have been systematically removed from the medieval times. Nevertheless, systematic excavation and sampling starting from the 1988 provide us a large number of samples and contexts for archaeobotanical studies. Concerning fruit and seed remains, this presentation is based on the analysis of 557 samples that provide around 340,000 remains. You can see in colors the different zones concerned by archaeobotanical analysis representing the whole occupation sequence. The Roman period is represented by the shaded zones, you have four zones, and the green circles, which are wells. Plant remains in Latara are preserved, charred, waterlogged, and mineralized. Charring is very common for the whole sequence, while waterlogged remains are only present during the 5th and 4th centuries BC and for the Roman times. So we have a gap in the middle. We have only charred remains. In general, among cereals, hulled barley and naked wheat are the most common species, followed by emmer and millets. Pulses are also well represented, especially lentils and grass peas. Concerning fruits, grapevine is the best recorded during the whole sequence, followed by olives and figs. We must note the diversification of fruits, as you can see on the bottom, during the Roman times, with the arrival of many different species, such as peaches, walnuts, pine nuts, etc. The gathering of wild fruits, such as blackberries or hazelnuts, is observed, but not very important. Other cultivated plants, such as flax, coriander, or garlic, are punctually attested. If we focus on the major crops in the intramural city, we can observe, according to the number to the total number of remains among the cultivated plants, that three taxa are predominant: hulled barley in blue, naked wheat in red, and grapevine in purple. Note the progressive development of grapevine and the high percentages from the second half of the 3rd century BC to the beginning of the 3rd century AD. What seems to show not only the importance of the fruit, but actually also the importance of the activity of winemaking. If we now see the distribution of the three taxa, not only from the number of remains, but also from the ubiquity values in red, we can see their importance during the whole occupation sequence. And we can also observe that grapevine, here on the left, is clearly predominant between the 3rd and the 1st century AD. We have to say that grapevine remains mainly come from concentrations of several thousand of items, what reveals, certainly, winemaking waste. From a regional point of view, this is a particular trend of latter. We can affirm that viticulture and winemaking is an important activity in this Mediterranean region, but is developed for the moment at the end of the Iron Age at a local and not yet regional level. If we now see the distribution of olives and figs, we can observe that the number of remains is not very high and even ubiquity values are quite low. The fact that they both appear during the oldest and the most recent phases is due to their preservation as waterlogged material. Finally, concerning fruits, we can also note the presence of exotic products such as bottle gourd, melon and cucumber, garlic and almonds during the 5th century BC. These exotic or luxury species won't be attested again until the Roman times, when, as we said previously, the quantity and the diversity of fruit species will considerably increase. We would like to come back to viticulture and winemaking because, as we have just seen, they are one of the major economic activities of the city. Several years ago, Michel P. and Ramon Bouchot already showed, with the graph you have on the left, the importance of this activity from the 3rd century BC to the turn of era. At the moment, they didn't have data from the oldest period, and they didn't take into account the Roman period. New data from these two periods show different interesting things. First, I have to say that for making this graph, we have also compared the grapevine curve that you have here with the proportions of amphora among the total number of fragments of pottery. We can clearly see the predominance in blue of massalate amphora for the oldest period, being replaced by italic amphora in red until the beginning of the 2nd century, which are replaced in turn by Gallic amphora in orange during the turn of era. During the last Roman phases, in green, you can also see African amphora. The three first types of amphora are wine amphora. The last one produced in gold. Actually, a workshop of Gallic amphora has been found in Latera, what explains the big peak that you can see on the graph. What does it mean? For us, until the Roman times, wine amphora comes from abroad, which leaves us thinking that wine, or the importation of wine, is quite important at the city. However, we have several archaeological evidences showing the local production of wine in Latera from at least the middle of the 5th century before, like a wine press found in a courtyard still in place, winemaking waste composed of several thousand of grape pips found into a clay container, also dated to the 5th century BC, and agrarian traces of a vineyard of 2.4 hectares dated to the 3rd and 2nd century BC, situated around 500 meters to the north of the city. What happens during Roman times? If we exclude the 1st century BC, the high empire levels show an enormous fall of grapevine remains, just at the moment when Latera inhabitants are producing Gallic amphora for exportation of wine. So it doesn't seem very logical for us this fall of these grapevine remains. We have already said several slides before that all this data comes from the city levels. From 2016, new excavations are done extramural in the Roman Port Basin. The work is still in progress, but the two last archaeological campaigns have recorded a channel in gray on your right, probably built around the end of the 2nd century BC, allowing ships to enter to the port warehouses, and a workshop quarter in red with levels dated to the 1st and 2nd AD, which is built near the channel. The channel is almost sealed during the 2nd century AD with lots of pottery, different types of objects, stones, and of course, organic rubbish. Okay, thank you. So, the new data coming from these excavations see that Vitis vinifera doesn't really disappear during the Roman times, but it doesn't have the same levels as during the end of the Iron Age period. We have here a classical example for us of over-representation or under-representation due to counting methods, because for that moment, Pip's remains are very, very important. So I think that we have to do new calculations in order to better understand the real importance of grapevine during the Roman times. To summarize from this period, we have great amounts of winemaking waste during the Roman times. We have just talked about the importance of figs, and but we still don't know its real importance. The same is true for olives. They look like more abundant in the port levels, but are still in minority compared to grapevines. And we can also say that in these levels we are finding a lot of new taxa typically Roman, such as peaches, walnut, pine nuts, plum, cherries. And what is also interesting for us is that some new luxury goods and ornamental plants like jujube and cypress are also appearing. And these are the first recorded findings of this species at the site. Regarding agriculture and other economic activities, we must say that we don't have enough data to judge the role of cereals and pulses in the economic system of the city. Hulled barley and naked wheat still seem to be very important, but we cannot say anything else because we don't have enough remains. Local winemaking seems to be one of the major economic activities, but we don't have also production structures. We don't have presses, we don't have basins, we have anything at all. It's still very difficult also to distinguish the characteristics of local fruit growing because charcoal and pollen analysis are still in progress. So this is what we are going to do during the next campaigns. And finally, well, regarding to the Roman archaeobotanical data, we can also conclude that the management of the household and production waste seems to have changed compared to the Iron Age period. Urban spaces are clean and waste is thrown away outside the city. And probably economic activities, such as winemaking, have also been moved towards the suburban areas. Roman concerning amphora, we have to also say that the Gallic amphora, which is produced in the site, are mostly from G1 forms, what are showing a trade, but in a very small scale distance. It's not for exportation of wine to a very, very long distance. So, I mean, the trade, or at least wine distribution, seems to be really quite local, I would say. Sorry. And to conclude, the site of Latera offers for us a good vision of the economic and social characteristics and evolutions in an indigenous context open to foreign Mediterranean influences from the Iron Age to the Roman times. So local winemaking seems important, at least from the 3rd century BC, but we cannot affirm a real distribution of wine, even at a small scale, even if the production of Gallic amphora is attested in the city. The importation of foreign plants or plant products during the Roman times seems to follow the tendency of other indigenous sites in Languedoc. The presence of exotic or luxury goods is not very abundant, and all of this can lead us to think that Latera is little Romanized because it doesn't present the same characteristics as other cities contemporary cities like Narbonne, Nîmes or Arles. Finally, we would like to drive your attention to the importance, as has been said, of sampling diversified contexts, urban, suburban, habitat and others, because they offer different and complementary data to understand the whole economic and social issues from a site. And I'm sorry for the time, and I thank you for your attention.